you're interested in being part of Janus Forum, we're really trying to build a community of conversation, not a, you know, a political community or an ideological group. Please join us and sign up on the sheet. I also should mention that we have further debates planned. We have a debate on NSA wiretapping for the spring planned, and we're also hoping to have a debate on the political role of the arts in a liberal democratic society, so please join us for those in the spring. Our topic tonight is economic inequality. As I'm sure you know, economic inequality has been growing in the United States for quite some time, indeed for a long time before the recession of the past few years, both in terms of annual income and in terms of life chances. According to President Obama in a speech given in Osawatomie, Kansas in 2011, the average annual income of the top 1% has gone up 250% in recent decades. And the typical CEO who used to earn about 30 times more than his or her worker now earns about 110 times as much as his or her worker, while the incomes of most Americans have fallen about 6% in the last decade. And that's from President Obama's speech. But perhaps the simple differences in income alone are not the most important thing. As President Obama went on to note, during the same time period, social mobility has declined. At the end of World War II, a child born into poverty had a 50-50 chance of entering the middle class as an adult. Today, a child born in poverty will have, if present trends continue, only about a 1 in 3 chance of entering the middle class. Surely these facts, if true, present a matter of concern for citizens across the political spectrum. Needless to say, we want to ask some questions about these facts. Questions like, are the claims true? And if so, what do they mean? Questions about the causes and the consequences of these facts. Some people say growing inequality is largely a product of changes in law and policy, say with regard to tax policy, or with regard to the waning power of unions. Other people say growing inequality has more to do with changes in the kind of economy we have, especially with regard to the growing value of intelligence and education. Or perhaps it has something to do with changes in marriage and family structure, or it might be some combination of all three. But the debate about inequality is not simply one about political economy or even about policy. The issue also, it seems to me, inevitably raises elemental issues of justice and fairness and the good society. It seems to me that we can hardly talk about this question for any length of time without relying explicitly or implicitly on some idea of justice or the good society. But, you might have noticed, turns out we don't all agree about justice and the good society. So it's something we have to talk about. These two facts together, the fact that we are always relying on some understanding of justice and that we don't agree about it, mean that when we talk about inequality, we are also necessarily having a conversation about our ideals, our norms, our sense of what ultimately counts in life. And that means, as we talk about the consequences, the causes and consequences of inequality tonight, we also need to keep one eye on questions like, when we say that inequality is bad or unfair, by what standard of badness or unfairness do we make that judgment? By what standard should we make that judgment? Better to be clear about that, better to be clear about the normative presuppositions that we bring to the conversation than to slide them under the rug or to treat them as though we all agreed, because we don't. Tonight, we're lucky to have two of the most prominent commentators in American political life on this issue to help us think about this tangle questions. Dr. Charles Murray is the W.H. Brady Research Fellow at the American Enterprise Institute here in Washington, D.C. He's the author of several books that have been both undeniably controversial and undeniably important for the public policy debate in the United States, including Losing Ground, which has been credited with laying the groundwork for welfare reform in the 1990s, The Bell Curve, which examined the relationship between IQ and class structure, and most importantly for our purposes here tonight, Coming Apart, a book that he published in 2012 about the unprecedented divergence of American social classes in the last half century. Timothy Noah is a columnist at MSNBC.com. After lengthy stints writing the TRB column for the New Republic and writing for Slate.com. He's also the author of what's probably the best recent book on economic inequality from the left, entitled The Great Divergence, America's Growing Inequality Crisis and What We Can Do About It, which was also published in 2012, and the reason why we invited him here tonight. So here's how this is going to work. Each of our guests will speak for about 20 minutes, give or take, after which we'll have a chance to have an exchange, perhaps even a genuine conversation between our speakers. Then we're going to open the floor up for questions from the audience. And there's a microphone over here, so you should be thinking of your question as you listen to the speakers. Dr. Murray will go first, and Tim Noah will follow. Please join me in welcoming our distinguished guests for tonight's conversation. Welcome, Dr. Murray.
We have a bunch of empty seats, four up in the front row, and there are some scattered throughout there. I mean, if you want to be able to make a quick getaway, it's okay to stand, but otherwise, if you want to sit down, it's available to you. Tonight, you are going to hear two very different perspectives on the unprecedented inequality that afflicts the United States. Crudely speaking, economic inequality and cultural inequality. But you have to understand that basically, Tim Noah wrote a book lamenting growing inequality and saying it is unprecedented and it threatens very important structural features of the United States. And I wrote a book lamenting growing inequality and saying very much the same thing. So the debate mainly is going to be me saying my kind of inequality is worse than your kind of inequality. And that's not, you know, perhaps what you came to hear, but that's what you're going to get. The reality is there's going to be a lot of overlap in terms of causes. A lot of the causes of the inequality I'm going to talk about also fed into economic inequality. And there is also a reinforcing feedback loop whereby growing cultural inequality has exacerbated economic inequality, and growing economic inequality has exacerbated cultural inequality. In a nutshell, my proposition is that over the last half century, we have seen unprecedented cultural divergence across classes in this country. What has made America exceptional has historically been able to tolerate high levels of economic inequality. That is not an anomaly in American history. It cannot survive this kind of cultural class divergence. I think we are on the cusp of becoming an ordinary advanced society with an elite that is perfectly comfortable of thinking about itself as being an elite and that feels much more kinship with elites in other countries than it feels with ordinary citizens of its own country. Now, we've actually had two developments at each end of the social spectrum. We've had the formation of a new lower class and the formation of a new upper class, a new elite. I talk about both of those in the book, but I got 20 minutes, and I've got to prioritize. So I'm going to focus on the formation of the new elite for a specific reason, namely that many of you here tonight represent the problem I'm talking about. Not intentionally on your part, but because of the dynamics that are in play. Real quickly, causes behind the formation of the new elite. You had two things going on in the 20th century, very large forces that were mostly things to be applauded, but that had a lot of collateral consequences that have created a variety of problems. The first of these two major forces is the brains became a lot more valuable in the marketplace for several reasons. On one hand, you've had whole new technologies open up that created very high-paying positions for people with high levels of mathematical and visual spatial skills. Think of people, we've all known this kind of person with really high math skills, but who you wouldn't trust to walk across the street to buy a loaf of bread because he has absolutely no social skills, he's a complete nerd. You know, what could that person do a century ago? Be an actuary, basically. There were very few jobs that could make use purely of those skills with no interpersonal skills. What can that same nerdy, socially incompetent person do now? He can make six figures in Silicon Valley. Or he can make millions of dollars for some of the quant funds in New York City. A second thing that happened with the economy is that as things got more complex, other kinds of jobs started to be worth a lot more. You know, why is it that lawyers these days can, in some cases, make four figures per hour or get commissions of millions of dollars? You know, a century ago, a lawyer might have been one of the richer guys in town, but he basically got paid for the kinds of ordinary legal services that people wanted. We did not have, in those days, a century ago, a situation in which if you were a lawyer that can negotiate a favorable ruling by a regulatory agency, you can be worth that four figures of an hour to the corporation that hired you. We didn't have international mergers or mergers of large corporations within the United States that require an extremely demanding level of ability to pull off and that make you worth a commission of a couple of million dollars. Now we do. But even in the broader world of just general management, am I one of those who thinks that a lot of CEOs are overpaid? You bet. But it is also true, suppose you're Don Draper. You know who I'm talking about, okay? You're a creative director of an ad agency. You have a track record of being able to increase the market share of your clients by one percentage point. Well, if you're doing that for a client for whom one percentage point of market share is worth $10 million a year, your ad agency is worth one level of commission. If you're doing it where one percentage point of market share is worth $10 billion or $5 billion or something like that, you are worth a whole lot more than you used to be. And you've had this be true across a wide variety of occupations. The second thing that happened is that we had a revolution in the college sorting machine, whereby over the course of the 20th century, concentrated interestingly in the 1950s and 1960s, we got a lot more efficient at identifying academic talent wherever it was to be found and shipping it off to good universities. This is a good thing. I mean, that's part of what America's supposed to be all about. You got talent, doesn't make any difference if your family's poor or what your color is, the rest of it, or if you live in a small town in Kansas, you'll get a chance. We made good on that to a large degree. Let me give you the example specifically of my alma mater, Harvard University. In 1952, the average SAT verbal score, that's now called critical writing, I think, the average average score for incoming Harvard freshmen was 583. Nothing to write home about. Just 8 years later, 1960, the average SAT verbal score was 678. Harvard, over those 8 years, a very short period of time, went from a school that had lots of rich kids, some of whom were smart, to a school where it had lots of smart kids, some of whom were rich. And the same thing was happening throughout the university system, and it's been continuing since then. Roger Geiger has looked at college applicants in the top five percentiles of the SAT and the ACT as of 1997. Just 10 schools took 20% of all the students in the United States who were in the top five percentiles, 41 schools accounted for half of them, and 105 schools, which only included 19% of all the freshmen that year, accounted for 74% of students in the top five percentiles. That is a lot of cognitive stratification that's going on in those schools. What's the downside of this kind of greater efficiency in the college sorting machine? Well, for one thing, college brings people together at a time of life when young adults are beginning to look around for marriage partners. And the college sorting machine brings together young men and women from the most able parts of the population, and so they tend to marry each other. If not in school, they are in jobs thereafter. So who do you marry if you're a guy and you are a successful rising executive and you've hit your early 30s? Well, you don't marry the girl next door anymore. You marry the woman who is litigating a case against your company. You know, and you are both selected for cognitive ability, and that has a variety of implications. For one thing, you put people with greater educational and cognitive ability together, and you have the makings of greater cultural similarity as well. You know, if you have a situation where one spouse in a marriage is one of these people, you know, the law degree and gone to Yale, but the wife, in this case, let's say it's the wife, has a high school degree, you have very different kinds of cultural propensities within that marriage in terms of the ways of spending free time and friends and the preferences in books and movies and all the rest. And when the whole neighborhood is comprised of people who have that kind of sort of internal heterogeneity, it makes for one kind of culture. When you have a situation in which you have a neighborhood which is overwhelmingly loaded with people not just with college degrees but with graduate degrees, and they also have money, you have a lot more market demand to satisfy the particular tastes and preferences that those people tend to have. Let me give you a comparison of 1960 with 2000. Because the tendency is to say, well, we've always had an elite. We've always had people who run the country. They've always been set apart from everybody else. Yeah, it didn't used to be the same way it is as it is now. And to make this comparison, I'm going to consider the three places in the country where, as of 1960, almost all the people who ran the country live. By run the country, I mean people who have national impact on the culture or the politics or the economy of the country. If you think about it for a minute, all the important political, you know, nationally important political jobs are monopolized by Washington. If you're talking about the news media and financial services, you've got New York that comes into that along with Washington. If you're talking about the entertainment media, you're looking at the Los Angeles area. Almost any category of nationally influential jobs are in one of those three areas. Okay, let's take a look at the kinds of population you had in the elite zip codes of those places in 1960 versus 2000. On the Upper East Side of New York, defined geographically the same in both years, 1960 and 2000, as of 1960, 24% had college degrees on the Upper East Side of New York, and the median family income on the Upper East Side of New York was $55,000 in 2010 dollars. $55,000 is not affluence. It's barely even middle class. It's lower middle class. It's not that you didn't have a lot of rich people living on Park Avenue and on Fifth Avenue. You did. But the Upper East Side as a whole was a very middle class or even lower middle class neighborhood. In Westchester County, you had 25% of the population, adults with college degrees, and only $87,000 annual income. In Northwest Washington, you had a somewhat higher level of education, 35% college degrees, $88,000 in median income. Beverly Hills was kind of interesting. Only 19% have college degrees. You can do real well in Beverly Hills without a BA, but because they had an average income of $115,000. Still not that rich. By 2000, all of those numbers had changed dramatically. So the percentage of people with college degrees in the Upper East Side was now 75%. Median income was $183,000. And the same is true for the other cities I mentioned. Essentially, you had by 2000, and it's only intensified since then, the places where the elite lived were much more homogeneously comprised of people like themselves. And that has consequences in terms of their life experiences, and especially the life experiences of their children, which are very troublesome. And this is where I come to where you play into the story. Some of you in this room, probably a fair number of you, grew up in upper middle class families, in good neighborhoods. You attended either private schools or you attended really good public K-12 schools. You went seamlessly there to a selective school, American University, where you are now. You are planning to go directly from AU to graduate school, law school, where you will then transition seamlessly into a career much like your parents had. That's okay in some senses. I'm not saying you're being evil for behaving this way, but what I am saying is a whole lot of people who run the country now, a whole lot more than used to be, have had exactly that kind of experience. If you go back to 1952 and Eisenhower's cabinet, it was called, was it 8 millionaires and a plumber? I think, or 9 millionaires and a plumber, I can't remember the exact number in the cabinet at that time. And that's true. All but one of the cabinet members of Eisenhower's were millionaires. But if you look at their social backgrounds, the great majority of them grew up dirt poor. They grew up the children either of blue-collar workers or of small farmers, or in one case, the woman was the daughter of a lawyer, but it was in a tiny town in Texas. By the time you get to the 2000s, whether it's the Bush cabinet or the Obama cabinet, you have a couple of people in each cabinet who still fit that mold, but most of them fit the mold I just described, where they've grown up in the upper middle class, they've gone to good schools, et cetera, et cetera. The reason this is a problem is that there is an asymmetry in the importance of a truck driver empathizing with the priorities of a news anchor man or a Yale law professor or a cabinet secretary, and the importance of the cabinet secretary and the news anchor man and so forth to be able to empathize with the priorities of a truck driver. The truck driver cannot screw up the life of the Yale law professor. The Yale law professor, if he has sufficient influence, or the cabinet secretary or the news anchor person, can affect the life of the truck driver. And we increasingly have a set of people running the country. This is not a partisan statement. I'm not saying this is Democrats. This is systemic. We increasingly have a population of people affecting the lives of their fellow citizens, whether in politics, economics, or the culture, who haven't a clue about the lives of ordinary Americans. Getting that point across is kind of tough. I talk in the book about the differences in the cultures that exist between the elite and mainstream America. But I finally put in a quiz in the book with 25 items that could add up to 100 points, with questions such as, have you ever lived for at least a year in a neighborhood where fewer than half of the people had college degrees? Good social science questions like that. I also have questions, these are intended for adults. Have you or your spouse ever purchased a pickup truck? Have you or your spouse in the last year stocked your refrigerator with mass market domestic American beer? The reason for that question is that the new elite despises mass market American beer. Their beer is made in Liechtenstein by elves. If I were to say the most important questions, and I will ask you to ask yourself about these questions, one of them is, have you ever walked on a factory floor? I didn't say work on a factory floor. Have you ever walked on a factory floor? Do you know what it looks like? Everything you are wearing, everything in your room, everything in your life is pretty much made in a factory. Do you have any idea what that environment is like? And the most important question, have you ever held a job that caused a body part to hurt at the end of the day? Carpal tunnel syndrome does not count. But aching feet do, if you just had to stand up all day. And the reason I say that's important is because if you answer no to that question, you are fundamentally unable to empathize with the very large number of people in this country for whom that's a daily reality. You don't have the least idea what their lives are like. And that's really important if you rise to have positions where you can influence the lives of those people. Well, I take great pride in sticking to my time limits, and I'm about at the end of mine. Let me summarize what I'm trying to say. And I'm not trying to minimize, by the way, the problems of economic inequality that I'm sure Tim Noah is going to talk about. It used to be really, really important to the civic culture of this country that everybody pretended they were part of the middle class. Where you go out and ask public opinion polls and people say, oh, I'm just middle class. Well, you have people giving that answer who, by any objective criteria, aren't even close to the middle class on either side of it. But there has been a wonderful impulse on the part of the American people to identify with being Americans. And you don't want to get too big for your britches. You don't want to put on airs. You want to see yourself as part of this large integrated community of Americans. We're losing that. We increasingly have people who say, yes, I'm part of the elite, and yes, I don't apologize for that, and frankly, I don't see why I should hang out with these other people that I really don't have that much in common with. That is not just a social trend that is worrisome. That is something that strikes at the heart of what has made this country special. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm going to disappoint you by stating that there's very little, almost nothing, that Charles Murray just said that I don't agree with. And in fact, I don't want to ruin your reputation, Charles, but I have been told that Joe Biden has been seen passing out copies of your book.
That's a low blow. We were going to be civil, right?
the working class and the affluent are dangerously alienated from each other. And I think it's very good to hear a conservative acknowledge this. It's also good to hear a conservative acknowledge that social class exists in the United States at all. I also agree with Mr. Murray, he hasn't discussed this, but I agree that the social indicators for the working class, things like divorce and out-of-wedlock births, are not encouraging. He documents it in his book, especially for men. Men are having a uniquely tough time right now, not just in the U.S., but around the world. They aren't adapting well to the post-industrial economy because, possibly, they lack the interpersonal skills at which women excel. Nobody really knows. This is a source of much hilarity in the comedies of Judd Apatow, but really, it isn't funny. It's worrying. My main disagreement with Mr. Murray concerns what I find in his book, an unwillingness to recognize fully the extent to which the changes that he deplores are driven by economics. And as he said to you, he's probably going to be arguing more for culture, and I'm going to be arguing more for economics. The United States has been on a three-decade inequality binge. Incomes have been growing steadily more unequal since 1979. This is exactly the same time period that Mr. Murray discusses in his book, and I don't think it's a coincidence. Now, it's widely believed that the income inequality is intrinsic to capitalism. That happens to be incorrect. In the United States, we saw incomes grow steadily more equal, or at least no more unequal, from the early 1930s through the late 1970s. Simon Kuznets, a Nobel Prize winning economist, developed a theory in the 1950s that said that advanced industrial democracies, by their very nature, saw incomes become more equal as they matured. He didn't put it quite this way, but in effect, what Kuznets was saying was that growing income equality was a distinguishing mark of an advanced civilization. That was the consensus within the economics profession until the early 1980s. As incomes rose for the rich, they could be expected to rise at least as much for the middle class. Poverty is a different story. It was lousy to be poor in 1955, and it's lousy to be poor today. It's somewhat less lousy because of a number of government programs, but it's still pretty lousy. So the real change has been the relationship between the middle class and the elite. Neither is inequality necessarily, as experienced in the U.S., intrinsic to 21st century capitalism. Granted, a number of advanced industrial democracies have experienced a rise in income inequality along with the United States, but none has experienced this rise to anything like the same extent. In France, Hungary, and Belgium, the income distribution is more or less unchanged. And in much of Latin America, inequality is going down. When we talk about growing income inequality in the US, we're really talking about two trends. These trends are largely, though not entirely, distinct. Trend one is the trend that Mr. Murray was talking about. It's the trend where you have an income gap that's growing between people with college or graduate degrees and people whose education ended in high school. Broadly speaking, this is a gap between working class families in the middle 20%, with incomes roughly between $39,000 and $62,000, and affluent to rich families, say the top 10% with incomes exceeding $111,000. This skills-based gap is the inequality that most Americans see in their everyday lives. That's trend one. Trend two, which you've heard more about, probably, is the run-up in income share for the nation's top 1%, i.e. families with incomes in excess of about $394,000. Since 1979, the 1%ers have doubled their share of the nation's collective income from about 10% to about 20%. And between 2009, when the Great Recession ended, and 2012, the 1% gobbled up 95% of the economic recovery. This has been a members-only economic recovery. Trend one is extremely complex. Trend two is not complex at all. The main drivers of trend one, the skills-based gap, are education and the decline of the labor movement, and I give each equal weight. The U.S. is no longer producing college graduates at a rate that can keep up with demand for them. And the result is that the price of a college degree, and increasingly a graduate degree, has been bid up. The high school graduation rate hasn't risen since the 1970s, and that's a problem. College tuition costs have doubled during the same period, which has hurt college completion rates relative to other countries. That's obviously a problem, too. Meanwhile, union membership in the private sector economy has fallen so steeply that the very phrase, big labor, has come to seem like a cruel taunt. Nearly 40% of all private sector jobs were covered by union agreements in the early 1950s. Now that percentage has fallen to about 7%. A union card used to be the economic equivalent of a bachelor's degree, but that is no longer the case, and in any event, there are a lot fewer union cards out there. On to trend two, the 1% versus the 99%. Here the causes are quite simple. Wall Street has swallowed the US economy, and CEO pay has spun wildly out of control. The Wall Street story is mainly a story about excessive deregulation of the financial sector, combined with a shift among investment banks from a partnership structure to a public ownership structure. Bankers are no longer investing their own money, they're investing the stockholders' money, and therefore they're more reckless with it. And they're free to be more reckless with it because of much more lenient financial regulation than what prevailed for the half century after the 1929 crash. The CEO story is about board cronyism and the growing tendency of corporations to hire celebrity CEOs rather than promoting executives from inside the company. And some studies have shown that people from inside the company actually make better CEOs. It makes perfect sense to me. That's the way it's worked in every workplace I've worked. Another contributor has been the shift from paying CEOs in salary to paying them in stock options, which for a long time were entirely off the books, based on an accounting fiction that the companies couldn't possibly know their worth. That change resulted from a well-meaning law passed by a guy from my team, Bill Clinton, that limited the tax deductibility of CEO pay to salaries under $1 million. It didn't apply to stock options, and therefore stock options took off like a rocket. Now, these two trends are largely distinct from one another, but there is one very meaningful link between them, and that link is a shift in our economy from labor to capital. Since 1979, except for a brief period during the tech boom of the late 1990s, labor's share of corporate income has fallen. Pension funds have blurred somewhat the distinction between capital and labor, but that's very easy to exaggerate since only about 1/6 of all households own stocks whose value exceeds $7,000, not something you can retire on. According to the Economic Policy Institute, a liberal-leaning Washington-based nonprofit, the GDP shift from labor to capital explains fully 1/3 of the 1%'s run-up in its share of national income. Now, I get asked a lot, why should we worry about these trends? And I think that Charles's book, Coming Apart, shows us why. Our society, and I'd add our politics, are becoming more tribal. A faltering and shrinking working class is turning its anger inward and engaging in self-destructive behaviors. And I'd add, at some point, the failure to incentivize ordinary workers with pay increases commensurate to productivity increases is going to screw up the economy, because it turns out it's not just those geniuses who drive the economy, it's also ordinary people, and they need to be incentivized too. If they aren't, workers will cease to care about whether their companies prosper, except insofar as that means unemployment. Maybe that's already happening. Meanwhile, coddling Wall Street's masters of the universe, as Tom Wolfe called them, has led to dangerous speculation of the type that gave us the Great Recession of 2007 to 2009, from which most people are still struggling to recover. I recommend to you an article in the current New Yorker by my friend Nick Lemon about the SEC chair, Mary Jo White. Lemon argues, I think very persuasively, that the high-powered culture of the Southern District, that is Manhattan U.S. Attorney's Office, very much that kind of upper crust elite that Charles is talking about, where White comes from, Lemon calls its alumni the killer elite, that this killer elite bias, which White has, biases her in favor of token prosecutions for wrongdoing at the expense of disciplined and principled but not terribly exciting rulemaking. You collect a few Wall Street scalps and everyone will applaud you for being tough. Never mind that at the same time, Wall Street lobbyists are swamping rulemaking proceedings that the press finds excruciatingly tedious, and that everybody outside the finance world finds entirely opaque. Getting the regs right is a lot more important than throwing anybody in jail. If you take away one point from me today, I hope it's that. Something else is changing too. In an article I have in the current Washington Monthly, I argue that another dimension of income inequality is that people are no longer migrating to economic opportunity. Now, this is a very American thing. Horace Greeley famously said, "Go west, young man." And we all learned in high school that he was expressing the ethic of manifest destiny. Well, actually, he wasn't expressing the ethic of manifest destiny. He was expressing the fact that the Panic of 1837, the worst economic calamity that befell the United States before the Great Depression, was wreaking havoc in New York City, that people were literally starving and dying in the street. And what he was saying was, go west, go anywhere. He actually said, go anywhere, just get out of New York. That is the way our economy has grown, and it's the way equality has grown over our history. Interstate migration is about half what it was three decades ago. Even unemployed people are migrating a lot less than they used to, and most heartbreaking of all, when people do migrate, they're slightly more likely to migrate away from economic opportunity than toward it. And that's because most of America's boom towns are only boom towns for highly skilled people like computer programmers. One of the more amazing statistics I came across when I was reporting this piece was that San Bernardino, the ground zero for the housing collapse, the subprime debacle, San Bernardino is a city that went bankrupt last year. It's attracting a flood of migrants from Los Angeles County. Now you ask yourself, why on earth would somebody want to move to a place that has no jobs? Well, they're not coming for the jobs. They're coming because the rents are low and housing prices are low. And when they come, it takes them very far from the places where they can work. Now, a lot of them are commuting very long distances back into LA County to work. A lot of them aren't. But the point is they are literally situating themselves away from opportunity. And I think that's a terrible, terrible trend. It's a trend I plan to do some more reporting on in the future. When the U.S. economy can no longer drive people towards economic opportunity, I think we have a problem that should concern not only bleeding heart liberals like me, but also conservatives like Charles. The good news, I guess, is that Charles is worried. I'd say the bad news is that while I think he's got the effects just about exactly right, I think he's wrong about the causes.
Thank you. So why don't we allow our speakers a chance to respond to each other. Charles Murray, I guess I'm interested, Tim Noah said at the beginning of his talk that you refuse to face up to the reality of economics and driving the negative changes that I think you both agree about. And I'm just interested to hear what your response is to that. I mean, what do you say about
that? Sure. First, this is a pretty pathetic excuse for a debate so far.
Please fight about something.
Sorry about that. So I'm going to start out with an indignant denial of something that Tim Noah said. I am not a conservative. I am a libertarian. And if you wonder why I haven't presented solutions, it's because libertarians don't do solutions. Okay, so now that we've cleared that up, obviously, do I think economics have played into this? Sure I do. But if we think that economics can get us out of it, I think we've got another problem. And let me suggest that we do a thought experiment. Right now, if you take a look at white males ages 30 to 50, and the reason I say white and the reason I give you that age group is because this is a group that has no excuses whatsoever, okay? As of 2008, before the recession started, those who are in what I called Fishtown, the working class, no more than a high school education and working in a blue-collar or service job, 8.5% of those with no more than a high school education, I'm sorry, 12.5%, were not even in the labor force at that time. And it's gotten worse since the recession. Whereas it used to be a cultural norm that if you were a guy and you were in your 30s and 40s, you either better be working or looking for work or you were a bum in terms of your neighbor's point of view, in terms of your girlfriends, in terms of your parents and the rest. When you have 12.5% out of the labor force, that's problematic in that regard. Now, if to the extent that a lack of good-paying jobs explains what's been going on in the white working class, then we can have the following proposition. Suppose we have an economy which goes to full employment. And by that I mean not only statistically, but where there are help wanted signs everywhere. You can work for as many hours as you want to work, not at jobs that pay the minimum wage, but jobs at $12, $15, $18 an hour. Do we expect that a lot of these males who have fallen out of the labor force will flock back in? And the answer is yes, we do. And my problem is that I have just described the economy that prevailed over the last half of the 1990s, not just for 1 year, but for several years. And you did not see these men flocking back into the labor force. We have seen a secular increase since the 1970s, early to mid-1970s, in dropout from the labor force among males. And whereas I'm perfectly willing to admit an economic component to that, there has also been a cultural shift in the attitude toward work. And the only people who don't understand this are people in academia. If you want to go out and find out for yourself, just go sit in a bar in a working class neighborhood and talk to people. And what you will hear is, as you talk to, let's say, a woman with a baby and a boyfriend who's the father of it, she is not going to say to you, you know, really like to get married, but Joe just hasn't been able to find a job that'll support us. She will say something roughly on the order of, why should I marry that bozo? He can't hold on to a job, never been able to hold on to a job. He gets a job, he shows up late and gets fired after a week, or gets in a fight with the boss, and he doesn't really even want to work. That's what you're going to hear. And I could go on at more length about that, but I submit this is a real phenomenon, and this is true of a variety of the phenomena that are creating the cultural divergence. Something's happened out there in the culture. A couple of other quick comments. I think there's a lot of truth in the problem of crony capitalism. There's an even broader problem of what I call collusive capitalism, whereby if you can get a regulatory agency to issue the right regulation that privileges your corporation over others, you can make a whole lot of money. And that is you're in the belly of the beast here in Washington, D.C., where that is big business. And I think that accounts for a great many of the problems, and I would like to see a Republican Party. I'm also not a Republican, in addition to be not a conservative. I think the Republican Party that came out ferociously and angrily about the deformation of what capitalism should be in the form of crony capitalism and collusive capitalism could get a lot of people sympathetic to it. But here's the problem. Suppose that we could get rid of the crony capitalism and the collusive capitalism. If that were the case, you would have a lot of CEO pay go down, because a lot of them are being paid because the compensation committee is a bunch of interlocking board members. That does happen. The dynamics I described are also true. If you're running a $50 billion a year company, talent can mean a great deal to your bottom line. And people are going to get paid a whole lot of money who, whether rightly or wrongly, just the fact they think these people can produce that kind of different performance, they are worth a lot of money. And the same goes for the people who are super programmers. They are worth a lot of money once you get rid of all the deformations. And here's where I want to tell you the situation is going to get worse, not better. Tyler Cowen, economist at George Mason, who many of you may know, has a book called Average is Over, which is terrifying. In some of his very plausible arguments, where he says, you know what? It's not really the low-skilled, the jobs that require people working with their hands and so forth that are going to hit the really hard times in the next decade. It's the jobs below the ones in management and so forth that increasingly computers are going to be able to do. Computers are going to do a whole lot of jobs that right now qualify as skilled white-collar jobs, and they're going to be able to do it soon. Those jobs are going to get hollowed out. So I just, Tim, I just want you to know it's much worse than you said, economically. Okay, at some point later, give me a chance to say why I think Tim is completely wrong to say we aren't producing enough BAs. As far as I'm concerned, the BA is the work of the devil. We can come back to that. I will leave it there.
That's meant to play to the audience. So, Tim, I have a question for you.
Yes. I first want to say that if Charles is going to deny being a conservative, then I'm obliged to deny that I'm an academic.
I don't think that we were confused about that, were we? But here's my question. What's the nature of the concern? Is it equality itself? Is it somehow some relationship between the folks at the top? I mean, should we really care about how much those people in the top 1% are making? Or is it a concern about the people at the bottom? I mean, is it a comparison thing? Or is it the fact that the people at the bottom are not doing as well as we might like? Because that's a different way of describing, you might both be morally problematic, but it's a different way of describing what you think the core problem is.
Yes, I think that both are very important. But if the question is economic inequality inherently problematic, my answer would be yes. People ask me when I give talks, why should we care about income inequality? And I always sort of start by saying that is a question that only recently started even coming up. 100 years ago, nobody would have asked that question. Nobody would have asked the question because 100 years ago, you had the economic elite in the United States absolutely terrified because we were closer, probably, than we've ever been before or since, to a violent overthrow of the United States government. I mean, you had anarchists throwing bombs at the Attorney General's house. You had socialists. You had communists. You had a very radical movement in the United States that was perceived as a threat. And consequently, it was understood among the elite that income inequality was not something it would be wise to let get too out of hand. 50 years ago, this question never would have come up because the United States was competing with the Soviet Union for hearts and minds across the world, and the elites in the United States understood that letting income inequality get out of hand would not be very good for our side's argument. So it's only now, when communism is more or less a spent force, and when there's no chance at all that the United States is going to be overthrown violently, it's only now that the question even comes up. Why should we care? I think that for the reasons I stated before, I think that our politics have become more tribal. I think, as Charles said, that the whole idea of e pluribus unum, which is at the core of this nation's experience, is under siege, that people don't identify as Americans. They identify by their class or their region. And as I also said, I think that it does eventually become an economic threat, that if you are only incentivizing people at the tippy top, then that's going to undermine the economy. Now, I'd like to, before finishing, like to talk about a thought experiment. Charles was talking about thought experiments concerning the elites and the this idea of kind of winner take all, that a person in the top 1% can leverage much bigger profits for his customers today than was the case 50 years ago. Greg Mankiw made a similar argument in a paper a few months ago defending the 1%. Mankiw said, sure, the 1% get twice as big a piece of the pie as in the late 70s, and the top 0.1%, which is really the people we're talking about, 1% really is shorthand for 0.1%. That's where you find the financiers and the CEOs. The top 0.1% gets about six times larger a piece of the pie than it got in the late 1970s. So the 1% are twice as deserving, and the 0.1% are six times as deserving. Now, Mankiw said, that's because these people are worth more. We have a more globalized economy, and so forth. And he cited three examples: Steve Jobs, J.K. Rowling, and Steven Spielberg. So I thought, okay, here's the game. If I can knock down, these are all extreme examples, ludicrously extreme examples. The most successful CEO of modern times, the most successful financially author of modern times, and the most successful film director of modern times. If I can knock down even one of these examples, then his argument is illegitimate, because these are the most attenuated examples to start with. Now, Steve Jobs, you got to give Steve Jobs to Mankiw. Steve Jobs really was worth a whole lot more than 600% of what he was worth in the late 70s when he went to work for Atari. J.K. Rowling, who knows? She wasn't writing books in the 1970s. She only started writing Harry Potter books in the 1990s. Steven Spielberg, great case study. Steven Spielberg. So let's look at Steven Spielberg. Steven Spielberg flunks Greg Mankiw's test. If Spielberg's market value to the world had risen steadily since 1973, when he made The Sugarland Express, then you'd expect his highest grossing films to be the most recent ones, but they aren't. Number one is Jurassic Park, which he released 20 years ago. Number two is Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, which is recent, but part of a franchise he started in 1981. And number three is E.T., released more than 30 years ago. And this is based on worldwide ticket sales that aren't even corrected for inflation. If you correct for inflation, then Spielberg's box office clout has, without question, declined. On the inflation-adjusted list, you have to go all the way down to number 10 to find a Spielberg movie that he released during the current century. Now, I don't mean to cause Mr. Spielberg any discomfort. Artistically, I think most people would agree he's actually a much better movie director now than he was back in the 1970s. If you haven't seen Lincoln, you must. I urge you to rent it. It's a wonderful film. But as a wealth-creating machine, he is much less efficient than he was 20 or 30 years ago, not more so. And in fact, Spielberg himself recently gave a speech bemoaning Hollywood's focus on creating mega hits. He thinks it's going to bring about a big meltdown, and I think he's probably right. He was at the event, George Lucas was there too, and Lucas said, yeah, that's probably going to happen. Here's the two guys who invented this. So that's all a long-winded way of saying that these generalizations about the greater worth of the economic elite today compared to 30 years ago don't really hold up very well when you get down to cases. Yes, for Steve Jobs, probably true for Yo-Yo Ma too. Everybody knows Yo-Yo Ma, the greatest cellist in the world. Is there anybody here who can name the second greatest cellist? I just last weekend at the Strathmore actually saw somebody who's, I don't know, maybe the fourth or fifth best cellist in the world, and I forget his name, but he was really good. So that's my long-winded
response. So I'm going to ask some more questions, but now is the time. If you have questions, there is a microphone over there, which will ask you to line up at the microphone. You can start lining up now. So while they're lining up, I guess I'll ask this question. What difference should this make for me thinking about public policy? Because I want to see a fight here. I want to understand what difference is the way that you see this from the way that Charles sees it.
I want to do something about it. I am not a libertarian.
Well, tell me what that is so I have something to argue about.
There are a number of things I would like to do. Some of which are politically saleable today, some of which are not, but if you confine yourself to the political saleable notions, you won't do very much to solve the problem.
What's the most important one?
The most important one. I don't do most important. I think there are many causes to this problem, and this problem took 30 years to emerge. It's going to take a while to reverse it. But certainly an important solution, one about which I think there's very little ideological disagreement, is universal pre-K. My kids, when they were 2 years old, they went to pre-K. Everybody I knew who had kids who were 2 years old sent their kids to pre-K. But there are an awful lot of people in this country who don't send their kids to pre-K because can't afford it, and so that's one way to even the playing field at the start that I think would be very valuable. And Bill de Blasio just won in New York City by pledging to pay for universal preschool education by raising taxes on the highest incomes, and I would certainly favor a scheme like that. Another proposal, which I thought was outrageous when I put it in my book, and then I sent my book off to the printer, and before it came back from the printer, President Obama had uttered it in his State of the Union address, to my surprise, is price controls on college tuition. Usually gets kind of a good response from audiences like that. He didn't call it price controls on college tuition. He used much more vague language than that. And so far, it's really just the job on boning stages. But I think that pressure needs to be ratcheted up gradually on colleges to limit tuitions, and that if formal price controls need to be instituted, I think we would need to start thinking about how to do it. Price controls are about the worst way to solve any problem, but sometimes they are the only solution you've got. We've learned that in healthcare already. We may be in the process of learning that with regard to education. More obviously outlandish proposals, I think that we have an economy that is not able to employ as many people as it used to be able to, particularly working class people. I think that we need to have a federal jobs program that will provide jobs that the private sector no longer provides. We already have the federal government providing benefits that the private work sector won't provide to low-income workers. For example, the many people working at Walmart who are on food stamps. We have quite a lot of our federal subsidies that appear to be subsidies to low-income people are really indirect subsidies to corporations. So I would bring back the WPA. I'd have a big federal program that would employ people. So those are a few examples. I would also increase the number of tax brackets.
Charles, would you like to respond to any of those?
We have so many people lined up for questions.
Okay. So questioners, please speak with a question mark. Identify yourselves as you ask your question.
I'm Greg Squires. I'm chair of the sociology department at George Washington, and I admit to some disappointment seeing the two of you caught up in the heat of agreement, but I want to raise a question about the importance that both of you attach to education. As Tim said, that the real difference is the top 0.1% or 0.01%. Those folks have the same level of education as the top 1% and the top 20%. Education isn't distinguishing among those where the real education is kicking in. And the Bureau of Labor Statistics has projected that by 2020, only 25% of jobs will require a college degree. So isn't the real challenge here one of figuring out how we can compensate low-wage jobs rather than one of figuring out how we can produce more brain people with college degrees?
Well, I think we need to consider a variety of solutions. I don't think that the 1% is a bigger problem than the skills-based divide. And that idea in my book has been a little controversial on the left. But I think that these are both very important problems. I give them equal weight. And a big part of the skills-based divide, as I say, half of it is education, but the other half is the decline of the labor movement. Mm-hmm. And bringing back a thriving labor movement is a crucial part of this equation. I think it's the reviving labor movement is the most important and most difficult challenge that liberals face today. And at the moment, they're not even interested in contemplating.
Two quick comments. First, I agree with you that compensating for low-skilled jobs is a major issue here. And I think increases in the EITC, earned income tax credit, are a strategy that is the obvious one obvious way to do it. I am on record with a book called In Our Hands for advocating a universal guaranteed income that would replace, not an add-on, a replacement for the entire welfare state. But let me just add a word about education. When I said the BA is the work of the devil, what I meant is this. We are saying to children throughout this country that there are two classes of citizens, those who get BAs and those who have only a high school diploma. And if you want to be a first-class citizen, no matter how little you are interested in a college degree, you better go get one. I would like to see a reformulation. And by the way, that means high school counselors will counsel 90% of their kids to go to college. Because if they don't do it, they're going to get criticized for selling their kids short. Let's redefine the goal of education so that it is first, the goal is that you've achieved success if a child grows to adulthood having discovered something he or she likes to do and having learned how to do it well. And that can apply equally to teaching history as a profession or plumbing as a profession. And the second thing is, let's get rid of this notion that this piece of paper that tells where you went to school and how long it took you should be substituted. We should substitute credentialism, which enables a young person to tell an employer what he or she knows, not where it was learned and how long it took them. And in both of those ways, move toward a system in which all of us see ourselves on a common career track. We all start out as apprentices. After we get competent, we become journeymen. And if we're good and work hard, some of us become master craftsmen. And let's do everything we possibly can to get rid of the artificial, pernicious, punishing distinction we now have between college-educated people and people who aren't college-educated.
Thank you. Hi. My name is Mike. I'm a senior in the School of Public Affairs here. My question is about labor and your defense of it, Mr. Noah, in light of the current economic situation. I find it curious that you cite Kuznets, who discusses economic inequality from the 1930s to the 1970s, which is the period when the labor movement was strongest, when we don't really look at the period before, when the labor movement wasn't as strong, right? When we see the kind of crippling and brutal inequality that was depicted in Sinclair's The Jungle, right? And so, I mean, is it not capitalism itself that's at the heart of these inequalities and the equal rise in wages between 1930 and 1970 in spite of capitalism, and thanks more to the defense of labor and its aggressive tactics, thanks in no small part to communist leadership?
I would say that an economic system that has businesses and also has labor unions is capitalism. Kuznets' theory was that the way a capitalist system worked was, first it industrialized, and during the industrialization process, you created gigantic inequalities, which gives you up to the Sinclair's, The Jungle. If you've ever been to the Tenement Museum on the Lower East Side, it's a kind of terrific way to learn about that period. But Kuznets said that once these societies matured beyond the initial stage of industrialization, that was when you saw incomes start to converge. And again, that is what happened starting in the 1930s. Now, it happened for a lot of reasons. Initially, it was driven chiefly by the government. First, it was driven by the Great Depression. But then it was driven by price controls and wage controls during World War II, and a general egalitarian spirit that prevailed during the war years. But then the big surprise was that it continued through the 1950s. Incomes stopped converging, I think, in the late 1950s, but the relationship between middle-class income and high incomes remained constant right up until the late 1970s. So I guess the short answer to your question is, I think what you are describing is capitalism. Capitalism is not just, not just a entirely sort of free market with no governmental controls and no unions. Unions are, in fact, private entities. They require some government support, but they are private. They are part of the free market, too.
Thank you. Hello. My name is Austin. I'm an intern at the House of Representatives. Mr. Noah, I think you were the only person that I heard bring up the topic of globalization. And I want to know, just in short, what you think the role of globalization is on the development of economic inequality. In particular, I want to bring up a couple of points. America has most of the biggest and most profitable international companies. And are the people at the top of these companies, the managerial class of these companies, are they seeing disproportionate shares of wealth because they're receiving global-sized profit shares for their companies? Are we trying to fit global profits into a national framework for measurement of economic inequality? And one more point. One thing that sticks out to me is that the development of globalization has also made the labor market more competitive, driving wages down. And do you think that plays a sort of other side of the coin to that?
Yes, globalization has definitely been a force for inequality. There's no question about it. There's a new book out by a friend of mine named Dan Albert called The Age of Oversupply, where he talks in great detail about this remarkable fact that all these people have entered the world labor market just in the last 20 years who were never in it before. He also argues that there's all this capital suddenly that's flying around and has absolutely nowhere to go because we've got a lot of societies that are all about producing and not about consuming. However, the thing about globalization is that it's global. Because it's global, we can study its effects on the United States compared to other comparable countries. And in my book, I tried as much as possible to look at the question, why is it worse in the United States? Income inequality in the United States is accelerating faster and at a higher level than it is in a number of very successful capitalist countries. We're all swimming in the same ocean. We are all swimming in the same global ocean. Why is the United States coping with it less successfully? And I think that these reasons I've been discussing really answer that question.
Okay.
Next question.
Thank you, and excellent panel. Thank you very much. My name is Michael Maybach. I'm a graduate of the American University. By the time people get to college, a lot of these dies have been cast. So I have a question about educational inequality K through 12. I live in Alexandria, Virginia. 60% of the grade school and high school children go to private schools, 60%, which means they never meet the 40%. The question was asked, has anybody been on a factory floor? Has anyone met someone that isn't in a private school? That would be the question where I live. So my response would be, shouldn't we give every parent a voucher for a good school and let them all go to the same schools, because we've equalized the voucher value for those parents?
Well, you know, my feeling about vouchers has always been, let's experiment with them and see where it goes. I don't see much evidence that vouchers and charter schools have hugely improved educational outcomes. I think when people tend to argue for them, they argue for a hypothetical that just hasn't materialized. I do worry about the decline of public schools. I do worry that going all in on vouchers would weaken public schools. And I think that rather than killing off the public schools, I think we should try and revive them. It's obviously a difficult task. It's obviously something we've been trying to do for a long time. I think that's the task. And the other thing I would sort of
I wouldn't envision public schools at all. In other words, we would move to privatization of all schools and let the parents choose the school. I mean, right now you have two classes, and the public school is the second class.
Well, I this is an argument the country had in the 19th century and the early 20th century, and we decided in favor of public education for reasons of expanded access. You know, the one danger always with vouchers is that they don't cover all the expenses. They cover some of the expenses, a bit like health insurance, and so over time they can be expected to erode participation by lower-income people.
I have a real simple way of looking at it. First, I think we pay way too much attention to test scores and so forth as a measure of whether as a school we want to send our kids to. Test scores are really very sticky, and there's no magic bullet out there that's, whether it's charter schools or vouchers or anything else, that's going to make that much difference to them. But look, you have some people in this country, I mean, there's nothing that most parents care more about than the education of their kids. And people who have enough money in this country can choose where their kids go to school. And that's important to them, that they have that choice. Well, we're spending lots of money per pupil in our very worst public school systems. The dollars per pupil in Washington, D.C., I don't know what the most recent is, it's way up there, okay?
12,000.
So the question to me is, and it's just a matter of, why should it be, as long as we're spending the money anyway, that it's only rich people who get to choose where they send their kids to school? If we can, without us spending any more money, give that same privilege to everybody else. And if you don't agree with that, then sort of my indignant statement here is, if you want to argue with that and say, no, we've got to keep the public schools because of the wonderful role they play, you better not be sending your own kid to a private school if you make that statement. Back in the 1960s, 70s, when Teddy Kennedy was passionately advocating school busing and for public schools, and his own kids were in a private school, and his press secretary said that this was a private matter that was irrelevant to his public position. That's the only time I almost threw a shoe at the television screen. And so it's okay to be an advocate of the public schools, just don't send your own kid to a private school if you're advocating public schools for other people's kids.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Jay. I'm a junior in the School of Public Affairs, and my question is for Dr. Murray. You mentioned the sort of meritocratic influence of the college sorting machine, you know, Harvard going from a school of mostly rich kids, some of whom were smart, to a lot of smart kids, some of whom were rich. And my question is, with the current trends of dramatically increasing college tuition, can this sorting machine maintain its meritocratic influence, or will it sort of succumb to, I guess, more class barriers?
Well, among the most elite schools, there's no reason at all why that you should not have a completely need-blind admissions policy. I mean, basically, when you pay tuition to Harvard, you are paying your tuition to a gigantic hedge fund. Harvard could give free tuition to its entire student body, and it would be kind of rounding error for its total wealth. Now, Harvard's an extreme example, but you ought to be able to accommodate kids from every background on a needs-blind basis at the most elite schools. The problem is that you increasingly have more and more of the kids coming from the upper middle class. And they're coming from the upper middle class not just because there are test prep courses that the kids take. The process I talked about, the problem with a meritocracy, I don't even know if I should say this because I'm opening up something that would take 20 minutes to explain, but I'll say it anyway. The problem with the kind of college sorting machine, which we will call a meritocracy, is that at the beginning there's lots of churning. As people rise up through opportunities that they didn't have before, the more efficient the meritocracy, the sooner that starts to subside and you start to get a layer cake phenomenon. And I'm afraid we're reaching the layer cake phenomenon now, and it's pretty scary.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Bradley Hardy in the School of Public Affairs. So I guess, you know, first of all, enjoying both your perspectives on inequality and wanting you to respond to a great body of literature that's showing that really family background and family economic status predicts children's adult outcomes, both within and across race, at least for the past couple of decades now. And so certainly economists say that, you know, some component of inequality is to be expected, much as, you know, for example, some of my students who might not work as hard as others, I would expect them to earn maybe grades that are a little bit lower, and that's just sort of a function of their effort. But do you think that there's policy remedies? And in fact, I was informed by some of the people who came before me, you know, talking about globalization, and I was thinking about the case of Germany, and for example, they've made great investments in apprenticeships and job retraining in response to globalization. Charles mentioned the earned income credit, and Tim mentioned price controls. You could certainly expand that to include the minimum wage. That's a price control itself. And so I'm just wondering if you all could talk to the component of inequality that seems to be not necessarily due to one's work ethic and meritocracy. Yeah.
Well, that shifts the conversation, I think, from the territory that I've mostly focused on, which is the decline of the middle class, to the problem of poverty. And that's a very difficult problem that raises a lot of different questions from what we've been talking about here. But I certainly agree with the proposition that it's a little disingenuous to complain that you know, the schools are lousy in the inner cities and it's the teachers' fault when teachers in the inner cities are being asked to solve a whole cluster of problems, only one of which is grabbing a child and giving it an education. So I think that, yes, I mean, we need to take a whole number of approaches to the problem of poverty. But it's been a difficult problem. We haven't found a surefire solution. We have found ways to make it somewhat better. And again, I think programs that have fallen into ill favor, like the food stamp program, and even to some extent the earned income tax, EITC, which was a conservative idea, has fallen into bad odor with a number of conservatives who have suddenly decided that it's a form of dependency that they can't tolerate. And you have a lot of outrage on the right that we saw a little flicker of during the campaign, that you know, a smaller percentage of the population is paying income tax. You know, that's by design. So I think those problems have, those programs have all helped. You know, it's demonstrable that they've helped, but they clearly haven't helped enough, and it's an ongoing challenge.
I disagree with virtually everything Tim said, but we have enough of a line here and we're running out of time. Okay, very quickly. Way back when they did the Coleman Report in 1965-66, a huge sample, one of the first modern quantitative social science things, everybody was astonished to find that the quality of schools, all the variables for measuring the quality of schools made almost no difference, that it was family background that explained all the variance in educational outcomes. And that has not remained completely the case since, but it's been, you know, pretty much the story. Here's another case of more bad news. It was always assumed that if you wanted to improve educational outcomes, that the things you would focus on are better teachers, better books, better, you know, all the ordinary things that go into a better education. And in the home environment, you would focus on getting people out of poverty, good housing. That's what's called the shared environment. So if you have two siblings, those are the things that they share. Well, with siblings, you can do a good job of disentangling what's coming from their shared genetic background and what's coming from their shared environment. The uncontroversial agreement is, gee, genetics explains a chunk of academic achievement and so does environment, all right? There's just no argument about that. But the environmental component of this turns out to be much different than anybody expected. And it turns out that the non-shared environment is what is explaining the difference between siblings. It's not the income level or the schools they go to. It's non-shared things like different hormone exposures in the womb, different things like accidents or trauma or peer groups or things that they do not share, or perhaps changes in the parental situation between the two siblings. There's very little that's explained by the shared environment, which is the focus of most of these intervention programs. You can't really intervene on the things that go into the non-shared environment. So when I said that test scores are sticky, that was what was at the back of my mind. Everybody agrees the environment's important, but the elements of the environment that appear to be important are the ones that are least susceptible to intervention. Big topic, have to leave it there.
Good. Next question.
Hi, I'm Jake Efros. I'm a freshman in the School of Public Affairs. And I don't know if this is redundant or actually the perfect follow-up to that last question, but a recent study came out linking intergenerational poverty to location and neighborhoods, and that where poverty is concentrated, upward mobility is a lot higher, and that something as simple as people who are in poverty living amongst people who are not in poverty increases the chances of upward mobility. I was wondering if there's some kind of way that we can create better designed neighborhoods and locations to combat that.
Yes, of course we can. And you're right, there has been there have been a lot of studies showing that those differences between the deficits of the shared environment
Seem to be a lot smaller when the environment is a more pleasant one. So, you know, I am hopeful that there are things that can be done, and I take a practical, experimental attitude. I want to see what, we have to try a lot of things, and we have to see what works.
If you try to do that, everybody who has the financial resources to do so will move heaven and earth not to be part of those experiments. And the reason they will move heaven and earth is that the formation of communities is essentially one of affiliations, where you want to be in an environment with people who share your values, particularly on things like parenting style and that sort of thing. And just as in the case of busing back in the 1970s, parents with the resources escaped that, doing whatever it took. If the same thing will happen with any attempts to forcibly mix neighborhoods, and the people who will get stuck holding the bag are middle-income and other low-income people. Let's stop social programs that rich people can escape the consequences of. Let's get rid of this whole idea of not, if it's not in my backyard, if that's your view of a program, don't advocate it for other people unless you are willing to live with the program yourself.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Nick Geiser, and I'm with the Competitive Enterprise Institute. My question is for Tim Noah. You brought up the problem of declining interstate mobility and sort of the flight of the poor from the cities. And I agree that this is a problem. I'm curious if you could respond to what I see as several regulatory forces that are driving up the cost of living in urban environments, especially for the poor. And I would name four: rent control, occupational licensing, and zoning laws. And if those are drivers of if those are the drivers I think they are, that suggests a somewhat deregulatory policy approach to solve this problem of the flight from the cities on the part of the poor.
I think that sometimes the answer is deregulation, sometimes the answer is more government intervention. I agree that rent control is a bad policy that is self-defeating. I think occupational licensing can be self-defeating. Although it's hard to make blanket statements about that because there's a reason it exists. But when it is used merely as a means to limit entrance into a field, then yes. And what was your third example?
Zoning.
Zoning, yes. Zoning has definitely contributed to this problem. And it's not just liberal type zoning. Environmental zoning. It's also conservative zoning. There are neighborhoods now. You know, it used to be that the classic kind of zoning in a neighborhood was nobody can build a house that has square footage above this level. Well, now you have rich neighborhoods that where the zoning rule is nobody can have a house that has square footage below this level. You have enforced basically enforced McMansions. And there are a lot of tools that can be used. I've only begun to start reporting on this, to tell you the truth, so I don't know a lot about this. But the central problem here is that housing prices are rising much faster than income. I mean, we had a housing bust in this country in 2008, and even now, housing prices are rising much faster than income. Median income is actually lower than it was at the end of the recession. Housing prices have gone up. So we need to look at ways to address that problem.
Thank you.
Good evening. Otis Holloway, I'm a graduate student at the School of International Service. This question is for Dr. Murray. You spoke a lot about the culture of the elite, but I'm actually interested in the culture of the working class. What would make it shift to a culture that wouldn't like to work? And I would like to know, is that related to prospective income opportunities?
If I had to pick out one thing that I think has had a lot of spillover effects, it would be the change in attitude toward marriage. So that marriage in the upper middle class is still alive and well. You still have you know, well, in the particular case of whites ages 30 to 49, which is the numbers I have from the book, you still have 84% in that group that are married, and that's been that way since the mid-1980s. In the white working class, you're now down to 48% married, ages 30 to 49. And the thing is that marriage has a whole lot of effects on, for example, men. This comes as no surprise to most people, again, except some academics, you know, when men get married, they tend to settle down and focus, and they're more productive in the labor market. It also has huge effects on social capital. Social capital of the kind that Robert Putnam talks about, where an awful lot of social capital is generated by two-parent families that are trying to create an environment in their community. And when you have a single-parent situation, they don't have the resources, in many cases, to generate that same kind of social capital, and in many cases, not the inclination. So then you say, well, what happened to cause that great decline in marriage in the working class as opposed to the upper middle class? And here is where I say, if you try to tell me it's a reduction in income opportunities, I will go to the mat with you on the numbers of the possibility of having sustainable income now versus before. This is not the time to go to the mat with all those numbers with time constraints, but I'll simply say economics really doesn't explain it. I put a lot of blame actually on the 1960s. I think the 1960s have a lot to answer for, where you had a sexual revolution, partly because of the pill, partly because of a bunch of things, and revolution and all sorts of other things, which the upper middle class experimented with too, and then said, well, time to get serious, and they were able to repair any damage they'd done. And the same kinds of dynamics in the working class wasn't so easy to recover from a lot of the damage to family fabric that had been done. And if I'm going to pick one thing, I would say it's the change in the status of marriage in the working class that is a prime mover of a lot of it.
Can I respond to that? I think that marriage is important. I think that a big problem there is, the dearth of what William Julius Wilson calls marriageable males, males who are economic assets to a woman. But when we start talking about the 60s, I just find myself thinking, Country Joe and the Fish did not deindustrialize the heartland. These places where jobs are plentiful and nobody wants to work, I don't know where they are. Maybe somebody can show me. I can tell you about a place where there are lots of jobs, a place that's an exception to the migration story I was telling earlier. There is one place right now. It's called North Dakota. Now, you may not like fracking, but fracking has created an old-fashioned boom in North Dakota. And North Dakota, for economic reasons, is a great place to have an old-fashioned economic boom. Why? Because housing prices there are as close to zero as you can get. Therefore, people can afford to move to opportunity in North Dakota, and they are doing it in droves. It's the Wild West there. It's crazy. People are pouring in. They have tent cities. It's like things you read about from the 19th century. That tells me that economics is a powerful force in life outcomes.
Tim, I will just say that we can go to Washington, working class communities, we can go to them in Philadelphia, you name it, we can go to it in Des Moines, Iowa, for that matter. The phenomenon I'm talking about of a lot of males who just frankly aren't interested in the labor force, it's real. It's real. And it's everywhere.
I appreciate you both.
Good evening. I'm Avi Snyder with the American Council of Trustees and Alumni. Dr. Murray, you talked a lot about kind of culture and cultural inequality. Mr. Noah, you talked about economic inequality and public policy, but I didn't hear so much about the interaction between the two, specifically the ways that bad social policy can affect the culture in very negative ways by encouraging deleterious cultural behavior, by eviscerating civil society, and also the way good social policy, like, say, welfare reform in the 90s, could possibly reinforce the culture in some way. So I guess what I'd ask kind of each of you is, Mr. Noah, would you be in favor of social policy reforms that encourage certain cultural behaviors, like work requirements for SNAP, or changing the way means-tested welfare programs work to stop disincentivizing savings and marriage? And Dr. Murray, I'd ask you, can good social policy help reinforce the cultural norms you're talking about, or are we all doomed?
Well, I would say yes, where appropriate. You know, welfare reform actually looked pretty good for a while. It looked like it was getting more people into the workforce. But it was not built for an economic downturn. Congress acted in bad faith when it pledged to loosen the standards in times of economic downturn. And therefore you had, for example, a surge in food stamps. It's not rocket science to explain why food stamps surged. The economy collapsed. Poverty, which actually had been easing a bit, suddenly got a lot worse. You know, should there be a work requirement for SNAP? Well, you know, maybe, but you know, I got to tell you, most people on food stamps work. SNAP is not really a subsidy for shiftless people. It's a subsidy for shiftless corporations like Walmart that won't pay their employees enough, and therefore the federal government takes up the slack to give them a living wage or to try to approach a living wage. So yeah, I'm not opposed to any of these kinds of behavioral experiments in theory. But I think the circumstances, we're way too quick to believe that the circumstances are people living in a weak-willed culture. Human beings and societies are much more complex than that.
I am of the opinion that with certain kinds of social problems that we have, the cause is by now irrelevant. And let me take the example of what is to me a huge one, and that is the increase in children born to single women, which I consider to be a problem not on any abstract moral grounds, but that it's really bad for the flourishing of children. Well, I am prepared again to go to the mat saying that a lot of the reforms of the 1960s contributed to the development of that problem. But as you had the phenomenon increase, the stigma also began to disappear. So when you don't have one young woman in the high school who's pregnant and is the object of great curiosity, you have 10, 15, 20 who are having babies and they're all very cute and they're in the school nursery, the stigma is gone. And you don't, at this point, then have social policy changes that try to reinstall the old economic regime, because you can't go home again. You have to talk, I think, with a great many of these problems about a cultural shift as being your only answer. And that's not something that lends itself to specifying here are steps A, B, C, D, E, F, G, how you get that cultural revolution, how you get that cultural renewal. But I don't think that we're going to have major improvements in the kinds of problems I described unless something like that happens.
Thank you.
We're going to take three more questions before we finish.
Hi, I'm Bill Galston, a senior fellow at Brookings, and recently became a weekly columnist for the Wall Street Journal. I mention that only because I came to tonight's event in part hoping to get great material for next week's column. But owing to the excess of not only agreement but civility, I'm afraid I'm going to have to find a different topic entirely.
You didn't like my crack about Country Joe and the Fish?
I'll file that one away. There's a famous story about Oscar Wilde. He was at a dinner and somebody made an insanely witty comment on the other side of the table, and Wilde remarked to a friend of his, "Oh, I wish I'd said that." And the friend replied, "Don't worry, Oscar, you will." At any rate, in the spirit of fostering, disruptive innovation, if not necessarily disagreement, I'd like to suggest that maybe we're not talking about exactly the right question. Because it's not clear to me that inequality per se, the sort of thing you can read off income distribution charts, is really what we ought to be caring most about. And let me give you some alternative candidates. Candidate one, we used to console ourselves by saying that, well, there might be more inequality in the United States than there was in Europe, but at least there's more social mobility. And that was a reasonable, or perhaps more than reasonable, compensation. It was part of our exceptionalism. Well, a lot of very good research in the past generation has put paid, as the Brits would say, to the idea that there is more mobility in the United States than there is in Europe. So it seems to me that we might be talking about the decline of social mobility rather than inequality per se. Thing number two that we might be talking about, and here I'll put my political theorist's hat on, is that there's a ton of evidence going back to Aristotle to the effect that you have strong, decent, stable constitutional regimes when you have a strong and thriving middle class. If you have a society that's more divided between the rich and the poor with a hollowed out middle, you have a formula for a polarized politics and perhaps even civil disruption. So I would argue that it's not inequality per se, but the hollowing out of the middle class, which is a demonstrable phenomenon in the past 30 years, that we ought to be talking about. Thing number three that we might be talking about is not the rise of inequality and this new wealthy class, but the fact that it has so completely decoupled itself from concern for its fellow citizens. I suspect that the people from different countries who cluster at the Aspen Ideas Festival have, oddly, more loyalty to one another than they do to their respective countries. In the old days, when you had corporate leaders who were wedded in all sorts of ways to local communities and to their country, inequality meant something different, and it was much more tolerable because it was more likely to redound to the advantage of the commonweal than it is today. So, mobility, hollowed middle class, decline of elite commitment to the rest of their respective societies, those, it strike me, are among the real problems, not inequality itself.
Bill, you are not permitted to ask the second to last question and give us 2 hours more of things to talk about.
Sorry about that.
But it is a serious point that I'm making. That is, I think the language of inequality and the 1% is largely divergentary from the real question.
I agree with that. But I think Tim Noah, in a way, in all of these things, we are trying to get at problems that we see in the society, and inequality is kind of a rubric under which we can attack those. And the things that you mentioned seem to me to be part of the things we are trying to get at, and actually have gotten at in some regards in the discussion tonight.
I would say that these things are all connected. I think that you are talking to a great extent about effects from income inequality. There is some tentative but persuasive evidence that income inequality reduces upward mobility. As your colleague Bell Sawhill has said, and President Obama stole the line from her, as the rungs of the ladder grow farther apart, the ladder gets harder to climb. I think that the obnoxiousness of the ruling class is absolutely a function of inequality. I think from reading Charles's book that he would agree with me about
absolutely.
That. And a friend of mine, I was at a dinner party. Actually, it wasn't a friend. It was somebody I met at the dinner party who was telling me that she had just come back from the Aspen Institute from a seminar. And I said, oh, how was it? And she said, oh, man, they had all these rich liberals there. And all they wanted to talk about, they all just wanted to piss and moan about their income taxes. So I think there's, yes, quite a lot to what you say about that. And I, at the risk of sounding like Kevin Kline in A Fish Called Wanda, I can't remember what the middle thing was.
The hollowing out of the middle class.
The hollowing out of the middle class. Yes, it's hard to know whether that's a cause or an effect, but it is certainly occurring at the same time, and they are both clearly related. It's just a little unclear, you know, in which direction the causality goes.
To be continued.
Hi, my name's Kirsten Rook. I'm a student in the International Development Program at the School of International Service, and I have a question about women and how they're experiencing inequality in the U.S. these days. And I'm wondering if maybe more women are educated these days than they ever have been. More women are the heads of households, and I believe women weathered the financial crisis in the labor market better than men did over the last few years. So I'm wondering if women are... if the divergence between the, you know, the 1% and the lower income earners in this country, if women are experiencing that the same way, or if women are having a little bit more of a straightforward rise in the U.S.
Well, just a couple of quick comments. One of them I'm picking up from Tyler Cowen that I'd never thought about before, but he says, look, the change in the nature of the jobs at the lower skill levels, conscientiousness is increasingly a really important job skill. You know, if you have a bunch of people digging ditches, you have a supervisor who can see whether they're digging the ditches or not. If you have a nurse's assistant, you can't monitor whether he or she washes his or her hands when they need to be washed. You need to have somebody who's conscientious about it. If you're hiring a nanny and you're a parent, you really need somebody who's conscientious. And Tyler points out that from every psychological study we know, and also for that matter, employers, you know, talking about job readiness and so forth, women tend to be a lot more conscientious than men. And he interprets that as saying in the years to come, women are going to experience an increasing advantage in the sort of lower, let's say the lower half of the occupational distribution, because they have a job qualification called conscientiousness in greater abundance than men do. An interesting thought.
Yeah, I mean, I don't disagree with that. I wouldn't just limit it to conscientiousness. I think that office work requires, which is increasingly what these jobs are, requires a higher level of social skills than a lot of men can muster. Women have superior social skills in most cases to men. And that's, I think, a big part of why women are thriving more in the post-industrial economy than men. Women are also better at school than men. I mean, it's actually the evidence for that has gone, you know, sort of way back. We just didn't notice it for a long time. But it really shouldn't surprise us that a higher percentage of women are graduating from colleges and now even graduate schools than men. We should be surprised that it took so long to happen. Because men have many, many characteristics that make them bad students. They're squirmy, they're obnoxious, they're...
ADHD is what we do.
So yes, when you're talking about the skills divide, I would say women have an advantage. Now, when you're talking about the 1% versus the 99%, you know, you're in Sheryl Sandberg land. And then it's a different story. Then those same obnoxious behaviors that make you unemployable at $30,000 make you absolutely irresistible at $5 million. I don't think anybody's thought their way around that problem yet.
Thank you.
Good. Last question.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be the last question. My name is Steven. I'm actually a graduate of AU and an aspiring attorney.
My question is actually kind of focusing on debt and whether or not you see it as a cause and effect or maybe a combination of some of the inequality issues you're talking about. Early 80s, debt to income, you know, 60 cents for every dollar earned. 2007, buck and a half for every dollar earned. A lot of people argue that debt is the way that perhaps the lower middle classes are trying to catch up to the elite classes. And other people argue that they wouldn't necessarily be doing that on their own, but we have a culture, if you will, both in government and in, you know, ordinary society that promotes debt as okay, a norm, way more so than it was in the past. You know, it's not a problem if you're $100,000 in debt or even more. You know, it's not a problem because you see our leaders doing it, and you see corporations sometimes doing it to fulfill one need or one goal or another. And I'm just kind of curious to get your take on whether or not that's something that might be, again, a cause effect or a combination.
Yeah, I agree it is. I mean, I think, yeah, easy credit is the opiate of the masses. It helped close the consumption gap between the middle class and the affluent for a long time. And I think it did help create problems like the subprime collapse. Again, I'd like to plug, he's getting two plugs in this meeting, Dan Alpert's book, The Age of Oversupply. He talks about this to a great extent. And he says, you know, if you imagined a conspiracy where all the capitalists got together and they said, you know, we've been paying these guys, but how about instead of paying them, we just lend it to them, then they have to give it back to us with interest. Now, obviously, that conspiracy didn't happen, but that outcome did happen. Yeah, debt is a terrible problem.
And we have kind of a natural experiment going on, where we have a subgroup of the population that tends to be extremely frugal, and save their money and reinvest it. They're called immigrants of certain specific groups, who are doing great and moving into the middle class real fast. And so, short answer, yeah. I think that I end the evening on another disappointing note of agreement.
Thank you very much.